Welcome everybody to the first AO Research Institute Davos webinar on behalf of AO Trauma. This morning at 9 o'clock we had 200 people registered, so we hope 200 of these actually come and listen to the talk. We're very happy to show you our latest research over the next hour or so, and I'll give first an introduction of what we are in the Research Institute and what makes us very special. So first of all, the right conditions for doing research. We're a multidisciplinary team of veterinarians, medical people, scientists, engineers, and all under one roof. We're working together. So unlike a university, which is based on departmental funding, we are based on project funding. So there is no competing for each of the project money. So we work together as one functional team. This is quite unique. We have a great surgeon network. That's you guys that are here now that are also on the webinar watching this, and also the ones sitting in here. This gives us clinical guidance. This is what most academic universities are missing. And this is regional clinical guidance, which is very important because problems in one area may not be problems in another. We have a central clinical trials team with regional knowledge, multi-center trials, accreditation, and expertise in evidence-based medicine. And again, these work in the regions with the competence from actually from our second center in Dubendorf. We have a medically guided approval body where we have expert surgeons from throughout the world that will look at techniques and implants and so on and give the actual AO stamp of approval. We also have a clinical education team, which is CME compliant. It's based on faculty development and curriculum development processes. How to use, network of users, feeling of a team and a family. And this is why AO is so successful. We are the only global postgraduate education group in the world. We have trained nearly 400,000 surgeons throughout the last 50 years since the first courses in 59, and nearly 160,000 operation room personnel. This makes us different to every other society in the world. Other societies may be just national, such as AAOS, or even international, but they do not have global postgraduate education, and none of these societies have their own research. We have our own internal research, plus we also fund external research. It's about 50% internal money for the CID, the clinical investigation, and for ARI, AO Research Institute, it's about 15 million combined, and about 15 million goes to external research grants. So the Institute itself has a very strong track record. We were the first part of the foundation from 1959, at that time guided by one of the founders of the foundation, Al Gerver, then Fleisch, and then 35 years of Stefan Perrin. The dynamic compression plate, this was invented by Stefan Perrin. Every company in the world uses this plate now. It was first clinically tested by Martin Al Gerver. The point contact plate, which then became the locking plates, this was invented by Stefan Perrin and Slobodan Tepic. This also is used everywhere in the world now. We've also carried on with developing with interlocking nails, with surface treatments that are slowly working their way onto all the implants. We can be very proud of this from a small little village in the middle of the mountains in Switzerland. We're a unique facility with highly motivated and focused multidisciplinary team. You're going to see this afterwards. We have all the speakers lined up that will be showing you their latest work. And we have connections to clinicians worldwide. We're also academically respected, sitting on many boards such as ORS, TERMIS, and European Society of Biomaterials. We have a motivating environment for fellows, so we bring fellows in which may already be at surgeon level and come and spend time over 6 months to a year to learn how to do research. Some stay on and come each year for a few months to finish a PhD or rehabilitation, and these fellows come from all over the world. As you see in the picture here with one of our surgeon fellows who's doing a PhD with us, Anne Simon from Leuven, who's actually currently at the back of the room but soon has to be running her own session on augmentation. So one of our main programs is preclinical testing. So this is the in vivo work, which is the closest step before doing a clinical trial. So we have areas such as a large bone defect, which is a clinical problem. We make actual implants for the animals that will that will be used to actually doing the test, as in this large bone defect here. We have 7 veterinarians that actually run this. So it's also the boss of their unit is board certified. So we really have animal care as the number one part of this area. It's very good in imaging as well, with CTs from micro CT with 20 micrometers resolution right up to clinical CT with 0.6 millimeters resolution, where we can put large animals such as sheep and goats. We were also the first laboratory to be able to section through metal with undecalcified bone in a plastic, and we were also the first laboratory to do immunohistochemical labeling of this, putting structure to function. These are a couple of pictures of our brand new made facility with the operation room as good as nearly any hospital and the clinical CT. Our biomedical services, here again we look at problems you will hear of, areas on osteoporosis, devices for actually giving resident surgeons information on whether the bone is osteoporotic or not, such as the density probe, and also we will take this further where we will look at the vascularization around the area so you can decide whether you should be plating, nailing, or actually putting a prosthetic in. We have our own workshop that makes the implants for the actual animal trials, and we have a big area on augmentation. You will hear about this again later. So you see an example of concept development. There's the treatment. So we have surgical decision making, implant positioning and anatomical reconstruction. You'll hear about this later from Marcus Windolf. Implant optimization with FE analysis, augmentation techniques. Again, you'll hear from this later from Ladina Hoffman. And new ways of monitoring healing, rather than having to bring the patient back each time making an x-ray, see what's going on, that we'll actually monitor healing by displacement. In Mauro Alini's program, we have the basic research and musculoskeletal regeneration. But again, unlike any university, every single bit of basic research we do is on a clinical problem. We are driven by the clinical problem. We do not invent biomaterials and then find out what to do with them. We look at the problem and then invent the solution for the problem. You will hear later on in several of the talks about our new thermal responsive gel, which has use in infection, use in delivering growth factors, use in delivering cells. You'll also hear afterwards about our stem cell work and some of our bioreactor work with the disc. Now, in our networks here, for example, the AO Exploratory Research Commission, when we're working on large bone defect healing, you can see we work with teams in America and in Europe. When we come with annulus fibrosis rupture, it's also bringing in Asia into this as well. And when we come with acute cartilage injury, it's also many areas. These are just 3 projects. When we look at our CPP infection, which is clinical priority program infection, with the AOTrauma, we're working under the leadership of Steve Cates from the University of Rochester. There was an open call made. He won their call. There were 17 consortiums who applied. We worked together with him, and this consortium's growing and growing. We're already attracting external grants to make more use out of the initial seeding money from the AOTrauma. And of course, because infection is such an problem, in the last few years we started our own infection group, improving in vitro models and in vivo models. And the main problem with in vivo models is the mechanics are really not very good out there in the world. So we've come up with our own system of defined mechanics with plates and screws and nails and distraction systems for mice and rats. And this has now become a spin-off called ReSystem. So our funding from the AO Foundation, currently we receive just over 8 million francs. And also we're bringing in around 3 million francs a year in extramural funding, mainly from national and international grants. We're also respected at the university level, so we'll be teaching the first applied course at the ETH. This is the University of Applied Science in Zurich. It's one of the top 50 universities of the world. And they're very good on the theoretical side, but again, we will be helping them because we have high knowledge and expertise in translation. These are our fellows, the ones that came in this year. You see the flags are from all over the world. So it's really regions of people coming in, spending time, learning basic research, and over time, they will actually become the leaders of tomorrow. Fellows who were fellows when I started in the AO 21 years ago are now leaders within their respective fields in the AO. We also teach young medical students before they've decided which area they want to go to try and encourage them towards trauma and orthopedics. We also in 1999 started the first open access journal, ECM, which is now the leading journal in musculoskeletal research. It's preclinical research. We have more than 20,000 registered readers, and our five-year average impact is 5.7. And the journal is now encouraging that we get invited also to present at different societies the way of publishing in the future. So this year that we were invited to EFORT in Berlin and also to TERMIS, the Tissue Engineering Congress in Vienna. The journal is also the official journal of AOTrauma, AOCMF, the European Orthopaedic Research Society, Swiss Society of Biomaterials, and the Tissue and Cell Engineering Society of the United Kingdom. And we're also endorsing the combined ORS meeting, which will happen in Venice next year, where again the CPP infection from AOTrauma will be running a symposium. Next year we will also be running a small congress. These are congresses limited to 150 people. There's about 50 surgeons and 100 scientists that we mix together, get a high discussion, 50% discussion, 50% presentations, and this year it'll be on stem and progenitor cells. So with that, I thank you, and I'm open for any questions from the introduction. Are there any questions from the audience? Are there any questions? Okay, we have to take one from the web. Oh, okay, here's one.
Yes. What's the procedure to become a fellow?
Okay, good. Very good question. So if you go into the AO Foundation website, so aofoundation.org, and put /ARI/fellows, all is open there. So we're full next year. We have 6 positions a year if they come for 1 year, or if you think if they come for half a year, it's 12 positions. We pay the same as a PhD salary. We will not pay your travel to get here. We will not pay your salary that your hospital pays. You must deal with your hospital if you need to have more salary. We will not fund for family to come over. This is not a vacation. It's a way to learn research. But we will pay enough to live here, and you become part of a highly motivated team. As you see with some of the fellows you can talk to after who are sitting in the front in their blue shirts. So there's a question on the web. Mara, what's that question?
Yes, good afternoon. So the question is how to join one of these researchers.
How to join one of the?
Researcher, you know.
Oh, so that program. I think that's the same question then. I assume that's the same question as how to become a fellow. So hopefully I've answered that one. There's a second web question, sorry.
Yeah, which is probably.
All right, for comminuted fracture. This is a clinical question that's beyond me. It says, what are the options for RX? I don't know what RX is. For comminuted fractures of personal femur. Well, I'm not a clinician. Sorry, I can't answer that one. You need to ask a clinician that question. So those were the two questions from the web. Any more questions from the audience before we move on? Okay, so with that then?
Yeah, okay, with that we go to the first presentation from David Eglin on hydrogel.
Hi everybody. Today I would like to present you in the next few minutes a few words about hydrogels. What I want to talk to you is what are these hydrogels, those biomaterials. What are they used for, actually, in your biomedical field? How hydrogel are important in bone graft substitute today? How they can actually influence the tissue response? And how or what would be the next generation of this hydrogel in the bone substitute field? So what are hydrogel? Hydrogel are basically a network, a highly hydrated network, which is able to retain a lot of water. This polymer network can swell, take a lot of water, but will not dissolve. Therefore, it behaves more like a solid, but with a huge content of water, up to 95% even. Their use in the medical field is quite widespread, from space filler, wound healing, viscose supplementation, but also drug delivery and scaffold materials. So basically, you can put drugs into the materials, and the materials can release the drug in a controlled manner. That's a typical use for these materials. In the field of musculoskeletal repair, hydrogel are used as supplement with calcium phosphate in bone graft substitutes. The use of this hydrogel is basically to improve the handling of those calcium phosphate particles, so you can have putty type materials, injectables, and it creates as well cohesion to your calcium phosphate bone graft. Typically, the hydrogel that are available today are fibrin gel, carboxymethyl cellulose, and pruronic, which is a purely synthetic hydrogel. However, all those gels do not behave in the same way. Some are very soft, so they will be weak, and some are very stiff, so very strong. If you have a soft gel, mechanically you can understand they will be less stable and they will be washed away. A stiff gel will allow you to have a more cohesive bone graft substitute. However, a stiff gel will probably have a slower degradation and therefore a lower bone ingrowth into your bone substitute. Angiogenesis could also be blocked by the degradation or the slow degradation of an hydrogel. Therefore, there is a very important interplay in the property of your hydrogel combined with the calcium phosphate and how, as a bone graft substitute, it behaves. And of course, this can influence how the bone will regenerate. So, we know what are the state of the art for the bone graft substitute. Autograft is probably what you would prefer, of course, but they are not always available. Allografts are interesting. They can be conductive, osteoconductive materials, but they are probably not osteogenic. Xenografts as well can be conductive, but they won't be inductive or osteogenic. Synthetic calcium phosphate particles by themselves are osteoinductive. They can sometimes mainly osteoconductive, but they are probably not osteogenic. Hydrogel combined with these calcium phosphate osteogenic conductive materials could be used to maybe bring some new property to those bone graft substitutes, and they can do this by carrying factors like growth factors and cells. So we go into a more biological therapeutic approach. So the take-home message of those few slides is that hydrogel are actually used for improving the handling of bone substitutes. It's quite straightforward, and there is already quite interesting application in the clinics. You know them already. Their rigidity or their stiffness can modulate the tissue response and therefore the new bone tissue formation. So there is a critical point here. The next stage, or what would be the ideal matrices, or the matrices of the future, will be those hydrogel combined with drugs like growth factors and also with cells. And we think that's probably where those hydrogel will be used in this field of bone graft substitutes. I will stop there and I will take any question if you have any.
So before we move to the audience, we have four questions that have come in. The first thing I'd like to say to the people who are asking us clinical questions here, there's one that's come in from Bangladesh about a supracondylar fracture of an 8-year-old boy with a median and ulnar nerve entrapment. What can I do? We are not able to answer clinical questions from the Research Institute. Sorry. Please don't ask. But what is nice, we are seeing people all over the world here asking questions. So one that comes from United Arab Emirates asks, are hydrogels available on the market yet? And our one isn't, but are there any others?
Yes, there is already companies that will combine this calcium phosphate granule that you probably used as a bone graft substitute, and they are combined them with hydrogel. Typically, pyrronic acid is one of them. But then again, there will be composite materials. There is probably not hydrogel bone graft substitute without calcium phosphate alone.
Okay, the next question on the hydrogel. Can it be used at cancellous part of the fracture, so maybe large bone defects and so on? And that comes from Nepal.
Again, there will not be used alone. Probably, of course, you need your fracture stability. Probably that's not the first option that you will go for. Probably you want to go for autograft. That's probably what you're looking at. But maybe in some specific application, you may need such bone graft substitute, and then maybe it's possible to use them.
A question from Egypt. How much does it cost? It's not available yet, so very expensive. A question... Which? I deleted the wrong one. Okay. Consider biological... Is it considered a biological implant? That's another question from Egypt. Yes, it is a biological implant, because, as David mentioned, the hyaluronin is degradable, so it's a biological implant. The next question... You've answered the one about defects. Oh, they're coming up quickly. Sorry. Is there an investigation line into children's fractures? Not with the gel, I guess,
Not specifically that I know, no.
And specifically also in the Research Institute, we're not doing specific questions for children, but a lot of our models use fast bone growth, so actually they could be representative of a children's bone healing. There are three more questions here before we move on to the audience. What are the specific indications for hydrogel in the clinical environment? That's a nice question from India.
That's a tough one. It's very broad. So I guess they should be available on the market and suitable for your application. Probably you go for such hydrogel when actually you will think that they will bring something to your patient. So it's a difficult question for me. As a scientist, I would say, of course, you should try. But as a surgeon, you have different aspects that you will have to look, like price, like availability, and so on. So, and practice as well. You need to be used to have. To have those materials in your practice, so training is probably an important part of it.
So the next question from Macedonia, so we really are worldwide with this. Is there any possible adverse event caused by the hydrogel, especially from pure synthesis, synthetic one?
Actually, it's a very good question. There are still a lot of questions in how hydrogel, like other materials, interact with the body. Of course, you will have an inflammation, and inflammation is good, but of course, the inflammation should not become severe or become chronic. Actually, hydrogel are very hydrated matrices, so they tend to be well tolerated, but still, you can have fibrous encapsulation in some cases, and that will be the case if you have a very stiff, slow, degradable hydrogel. So when we develop hydrogel, for example, we develop hydrogel that will degrade fast, that will not stay for very long in the body, that will degrade with a release of byproducts which are non-toxic and well tolerated by the body. So of course, this is a very critical question.
So with 200 people registered here, the questions are coming in thick and fast. One is asking, can we use BMP with the hydrogel? That comes from United Arab Emirates. Another one in Egypt, what about the chemistry? I think you've answered the chemistry quite well already. Will hydrogel one day replace autologous graft? And why could it be better? I think these are rather to save the time to get the next talk. This could be used eventually for releasing growth factors. The chemistry is as biological as we can make it at the moment. And yes, and eventually it would be good to replace autologous bone graft, but it's nowhere near there yet. We probably, in time reasons, should move on to the next talk. Is there one question from the audience before we move on? Or are we getting it covered quite well by the rest of the world here, I think? Okay. Mauro, Nick, we'll introduce the next one then.
Yeah, so the next speaker is on antibiotic prophylaxis and will be given by Finton Moriatis.
Thanks, Mauro. So I'm going to talk to you about infection. So the musculoskeletal infection group is where I'm working at the ARI. And the talk I'm going to give to you today is linking in with what David Eglin just presented in terms of what is biomaterials research at ARI doing in the question of infection. So just to give a quick introduction, I think everybody will be quite familiar with this, but there is a risk of developing an infection for any surgical procedure as soon as the skin, the barrier to bacterial penetration is opened. There's a risk that contaminating bacteria can move from the skin onto the implant. And we know that the presence of an implant means that you can have a biofilm formation, and it's present regardless of whether the patient is a severe trauma or a routine elective procedure. We also know that the case of an infection can be quite expensive. And we see here that the case for a non-infected cases in terms of hip fractures was causing a pound sterling cost of 9,000 per case. When you had a superficial infection, the cost increased to £26,000. And when that went to a deep infection requiring removal surgery, actually the cost was increased four times. I think that is probably maybe a relatively conservative estimate of the effect of having an infection. The next point that I wanted to make quickly was that the therapeutic and prophylactic use of systemic and local antibiotics has resulted in a reduction in the infection rate, an improvement in the outcome of treatment of these infections, but also importantly, it has caused an increase in antibiotic resistance amongst bacteria that cause these infections. So the next slide is a quick summary of some of the important information that I would say maybe is kind of interesting in terms of local delivery of antibiotics. So we do know that the local delivery of antibiotics achieves higher local concentrations than what is achievable by systemic antibiotic delivery. We know that this reduces the risk of developing toxicity. And we also know that these high concentrations of even standard antibiotics can be effective against bacteria that are resistant to those antibiotics. And that's because the concentration is so much higher than you would have in your serum. And this graph is actually quite an interesting point that I just wanted to make. It's not necessarily so connected, but the point from this study from 2003 showed that the use of prophylactic antibiotics, either in bone cement and in terms of your intravenous shot of antibiotics, can reduce the risk of developing an aseptic loosening. Not only does it reduce the rate of overt, obvious, clear infection, but it also reduces aseptic loosening, which means that there's a lot of subacute, maybe low-grade infections that are not generally detected. So that's the good side of the local antibiotic therapy, but one important point is that these materials, once the antibiotic is released, actually serve as a substrate for biofilm formation by bacteria, and those suboptimal concentrations of antibiotics locally can induce resistance to that antibiotic within the contaminating bacteria. So this picture here shows from Danielle and Noit in the Netherlands from 2001, Staphylococcus aureus growing on gentamicin-loaded PMMA beads that were used in the treatment of fractures. And not only was there a biofilm forming on it, but these bacteria were actually resistant to gentamicin. So that's a clear, simple indication that these local delivery vehicles are not necessarily going to solve every problem. So the question then is, how can research improve this? What can we do, or what do we need to do to start answering this, preventing this problem? So the first would be controlling the release of the antimicrobial. And we know that through collaboration with people like David Eglin previously, that we can actually control the release rate of antibiotics from materials to an extent that we're not just having a single burst release of the antibiotic, but we're able to control the release rate of the antibiotic over time, maintain an effective therapeutic local concentration, and we would expect that that would allow the use of less total amount of antibiotics and increase the local efficacy in preventing and treating these infections. It would also obviously then have a reduced toxicity and greater potency. And at the Research Institute, we're now at the preclinical phase of testing these materials. You will see this from our group and others, and I think this is the way material science in terms of delivering antibiotics will be moving in the future. So we've got the controlled release rate. That's under investigation right now, but the question is, are there more challenges? Is that going to solve all our problems or not? And I think realistically, we've got to think that if we think from a coating or from a PMMA loaded with antibiotics, the penetration of that antibiotic is quite limited. From the data, we see that it can penetrate into the wound hematoma, but it might only penetrate 1 centimeter of bone or a few centimeters of soft tissue. So not really getting penetration of the antibiotic right throughout the wound. We also know that the bacteria are not necessarily always right in the center of the wound. They can adhere to bone within crevices. Remnants of biofilm can be formed relatively distant to any wound. And we also know that if you have an antibiotic-loaded material, that once the antibiotic is gone, it can serve as the substrate for biofilm formation. So these are three big challenges that we need to answer, and maybe even controlled release from a coating are not going to answer. So this is where the project with the previous speaker, David Eglin, comes in. We're looking at the same hydrogel that he described, and we're looking at functionalizing this with antibiotics, both in terms of them being mixed in, into the hydrogel matrix, which would allow very rapid release, are also actually chemically binding the antibiotic within the hydrogel so that it is only released when the hydrogel degrades. And for some of the hydrogel formulations that David has already prepared, we see that there is a relatively rapid or there can be a controllable degradation, but the fact that it degrades means that it doesn't serve as a substrate for biofilm formation. So when the antibiotic is gone, the material is gone, there's nothing for the bacteria to adhere to. We also know that it being a hydrogel means it's not formed into nice, neat circles or beads, so it does creep within the wound. It will make its way into some of the crevices where we think that maybe the bacteria are residing, and it gives a much more likely increased chance to have an effect on these bacteria that may be more distant from the wound site. So just quickly then, the simple points that I wanted to make today were that local antibiotic delivery does reduce infection rates, and it does reduce aseptic complications. We know that local delivery from conventional carriers are effective in limiting contaminating bacteria, but not 100%, and they do have limitations. Improving the temporal and the spatial, so over time and the locations at which the antibiotic is being delivered, would be expected to improve the performance of the standard currently available antibiotic delivery vehicles, and the hydrogel might be a particularly suitable solution to some of those problems. Thank you very much.
So while Jeff is screening the questions that are coming on via internet, do we have some questions from the audience? Yep, it's coming.
Am I allowed to ask three questions?
Sure.
Or one question?
Three. Short question.
The first question, why do you use gentamicin? Because gentamicin is now, I think it's the oldest antibiotic, and majority of the bacteria are Staphylococcus aureus with methicillin, the MRSA, which gentamicin has no effect at all.
Well, I guess
that's one question.
The quick answer to that would be that the resistance to gentamicin is very much a level based on serum pharmacokinetics. We're not basing its activity on the serum concentration. Locally, we would expect to have a much higher, 100, 200 times more of the antibiotic, and when you have that much more, you would still expect it to have an effect. If we were looking at antibiotics that were particularly active against MRSA, I think, you know, we're a long way in terms of developing a product. Maybe eventually you would be looking to include vancomycin, teicoplanin, and something like that. But, you know, we're at the research phase right now.
The bioavailability of the antibiotic is not more than 48 hours. It is degraded within 48 hours. The first 48 hours release is active. Otherwise, rest of the antibiotic is not released or is damaged by the system itself. Hydrogel is going to control the antibiotic release.
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely true that, you know, antibiotics are somewhat at risk of degradation, whether that's due to heat or enzymatic degradation. But that's not completely established for all antibiotics, I would say. And we would say within, for example, within the coating that I described, the antimicrobial agents are protected within a little liposome. So they're completely protected until which time it's degraded, and then they're released as an active particle. And it's something that we would test in terms of the hydrogel, whether it is protecting them in the same way or not. It is an important question, but I wouldn't think it's a particularly big concern right now.
We are using with the bone cement.
Which question is that?
Third question.
Third question, okay.
The bone cement, we are using the beads with the bone cement. it gives the same effect as the other. So what is the, because it must be a very cheap option rather than to go for a hydrogel mixed antibiotic.
Yeah, but the beads need to be surgically removed, and once the antibiotic is gone, if they haven't really had a very good release profile, the bacteria might still be there, and then they can form a biofilm on the implant as was shown in the picture.
I'd like to add to that as well. The problem with the beads as well, they take a lot of space when you put them into the body. The gel will fill all dead space. It's a liquid, and then as it goes into the body, it gelifies. So it'll cover all the area. The beads are quite large. They take a lot of room, and as he mentioned, they need removal. So the beads are not the long-term future for releasing antibiotics. We're talking about any implant, any shape, any design, and a gel will fill all the dead spaces. So it'll be a long time until it gets FDA approval, but after that comes out, I don't see much option for the beads apart from the cheap option in small cases. Now I have to take some of the ones from the web. Okay, so first of all, bone cement with antibiotics will be replaced from hydrogel. I'll predict yes eventually, but it's going to take at least 15, 20 years, I would guess, on that. Are there any systemic manifestations that you've encountered?
Well, we haven't tested the hydrogel in vivo. I would say certainly there would be no systemic manifestations from the antibiotic levels that we're including. It's an open question. I think something we would have to test in vivo in collaboration with David to answer the effects of the hydrogel.
So a question from Egypt. What is the most effective antibiotic family used?
Well, I guess the reason, say, for instance, right now that gentamicin is used, maybe you say, okay, I would agree that it's maybe not 100% potent against every bacterium, but it's one that is sort of clinically used, as there's a certain amount of regulatory familiarity with it. So that is the reason that antibiotic would be used, and I think that's quite a good reason.
We have to be aware as well, resistance isn't new. They found bacteria in ice from 40,000 years ago that have resistance to vancomycin before we've even discovered vancomycin. So this isn't new. The bacteria have been around a long time, but it's how we actually use these to fight the bacteria. The second thing with resistance as well, they often do this in cultures, and we culture in brain-heart infusion media and tryptic soya broth, which gives a phenotype shock to the bacteria. And that's why gentamicin is still pretty effective when it's in the body. One more question maybe. Well, they asked what antibiotics are used with hydrogels. Well, the answer to that is we've tested with ciprofloxacin and gentamicin, but we haven't tested others yet. That will come. And another question from Egypt, how can antibiotics decrease aseptic loosening? I don't think Fintan mentioned it'll decrease aseptic loosening, but what we're saying is the actual diagnosis is not very good at the moment. Fintan, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, so I think the aseptic was inverted commas. It's not obviously aseptic loosening if there's a bacterial involvement. So that's the point. Yeah.
And then what about this is a great question from India. What about the immune response to these hydrogels in vivo? Good question.
Yeah, it's an interesting question, and I think, again, without referring too much back to David Egan, it's a hydrogel issue, and I think we also know that the immune response to biomaterials will have an effect on the local bacteria, and it's unknown. We haven't done this test, but I think it would be a very interesting point to raise, and certainly part of what we would look to be investigating.
Okay, thanks, Fintan. We move on intervertebral disc now, and maybe a new way to regenerate it. Sibylle Grat.
Thank you. Okay. So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to present you today a new concept for intervertebral disc repair or regeneration based on the activation or acceleration of endogenous repair mechanisms in order to achieve a more sustained effect. As you all know, current surgical treatment of intervertebral disc disorders often appears unsatisfactory, especially in long term. Biological solutions have therefore been investigated in preclinical research, such as the application of growth factors, drug therapy, gene therapy, cell therapy, or tissue engineering. However, there are still a lot of open questions regarding the safety and efficacy of these new methods. And it is therefore of particular interest to investigate endogenous repair mechanisms, such as the principle of stem or progenitor cell homing. This principle of stem or progenitor cell homing has previously been shown in other tissues, such as in wound healing or in ischemia. In the degenerative disc, the degrading disc would release chemoattractants from damaged or dying disc cells, and these chemotactic molecules in turn would attract stem or progenitor cells from surrounding tissues that would migrate towards the site of damage, towards the site of injury. These homed stem or progenitor cells could then help to regenerate the damaged intervertebral disc. The questions to ask in this context are first, whether this stem or progenitor cell migration towards the site of injury can also be observed in the diseased intervertebral disc, and if yes, whether this can be utilized to delay the degeneration or to stimulate repair or regeneration of the intervertebral disc. To address the first question, an ex vivo proof of concept study was performed using our intervertebral disc bioreactor system. With this intervertebral disc whole organ culture system, we are able to culture large animal intervertebral discs, such from bovine or ovine, under either healthy or degenerative culture conditions. Healthy or degenerative culture conditions can be achieved by variation of the loading and nutrition conditions of the intervertebral disc. Thereby, the healthy intervertebral discs are cultured under low frequency loading and with high glucose supply and can be maintained viable for up to several weeks. On the other hand side, the degenerative discs are cultured under very high frequency loading and with reduced glucose supply, and they show signs of cell death and signs of early disc degeneration after already a few days. In order to investigate the homing of bone marrow-derived mesenchymal stem cells into the intervertebral disc, bovine intervertebral discs were cultured under either healthy or under degenerative culture conditions for 1 week. Then cell suspensions were prepared by labeling human bone marrow-derived mesenchymal stem cells with a fluorescent dye. The cell suspensions were then co-cultured with the intervertebral discs for 7 days, and after culture, the discs that migrated towards the center, the cells that migrated towards the cell, the center of the disc, were visualized by fluorescence microscopy. Confirming our hypothesis, the amount of cells that migrated towards the center of the disc was much higher in the degenerative cultured disc compared to the healthy cultured disc. And in addition, the conditioned culture medium of the degenerative cultured disc showed chemotactic activity towards human mesenchymal stem cells, confirming that actually the factors that are released by the degenerative cultured discs are responsible for inducing the migration of the cells into the, towards the center of the disc. So to conclude, in response to damage, mesenchymal stem cells are able to migrate towards the center of the intervertebral disc, and this process is mediated by chemotactic factors that are released by the damaged or by dying disc cells. And therefore, the delivery of chemotactic molecules in order to mobilize the endogenous progenitor cells and therefore to activate or to accelerate endogenous repair mechanisms represents an attractive new approach for intervertebral disc regenerative therapy. A particularly attractive strategy in this respect would be the injectable chemoattractive scaffold consisting of a chemoattractant molecule in combination with an injectable hydrogel that could be delivered to a degenerative disc in order to stimulate the migration of the stem or progenitor cells from surrounding tissue that would then contribute to tissue regeneration. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer your questions.
Thanks, Sibylle. I know that it's not metal here, it's a cell question from the audience.
Okay. And we don't have any questions from the web, but I'd like to make a call to the people on the web. I'd like to see some questions come in also from Europe, USA. Oh, here comes one as I ask. Okay, United Arab Emirates. What is the future of this study? Can we look forward to disc regeneration therapeutically? Good question.
Yeah, that's a good question. We think that the future of biological disc regeneration may be the injection of cells, injection of growth factors, injection of biomaterials, but more and more we also aim to activate endogenous repair mechanisms, because the delivery of combined factors, cells, materials is a very, very complex system, which might be not so clinically relevant or not within a reasonable time. So we think if we can, with a relatively basic concept, activate endogenous repair mechanisms, that would be more relevant in the future than a combination of a lot of cells, factors, and materials.
So we have a question from the audience. I guess this follows on from that.
Would this be analogous to bone healing as well? After all, these are progenitor cells. It matters
that is a
the
very
cells can replicate
question.
Into anything.
Mm-hmm. This is a very good question. And in fact, this concept of a stem or progenitor cell homing to sites of injury is not specific at all to the intervertebral disc. And it could be used for any other tissue, for any other healing, also specifically for bone healing. It has even been shown in bone healing in an experimental setting.
So I could get black hair again. Those who are bald would not have a problem. We could be young again. So what is holding us back from what tells us that this is not working yet? Why are we not being able to proceed further?
Maybe I can add on that. For example, in the bone, bone heal in the majority of the cases, if it's not critical size defect, maybe it doesn't heal well, but there is a clear homing effect where the progenitor cell are driven to the site of injury. Why you don't get young? Because with aging, these progenitor cells, this number of potential mesenchymal cells are less and less. So the idea also here is that we would like to maybe increase the number or reactivate the cell that for sure during aging are less and less active. So that's why you don't get young. Mm-hmm. But you get.
And especially in the intervertebral disc.
Sybil, two quick questions from the web here with very short answers. How about the immunological response to the chemotractants? That's number one. Short answer, please. That comes first European question from Bulgaria. Mauro, you take it then.
There is no immune because the chemoattractant is not synthetic, but it's human, biologic. So.
Yeah. Okay, a question for you, Sybil. How would the hydrogel be retained within the disc space? How would you ensure that it does not spill into the neural canal? And that comes from India.
That's a very good question. In fact, this is exactly what we are currently investigating. We are investigating best methods how to deliver this hydrogel in the disc, whether we deliver it through the end plate or through the annulus. That's what we are looking at the moment, which would be the best way to avoid leakage. That's a good question.
Okay, the question from Macedonia, you don't have to answer because they said, sounds great. Can this be applied to other tissues? Yes, we are looking at other tissues, but stop us from aging? No. And would we want it? We already have 7 billion people on this planet. From Ecuador, is it a problem to use biological system with hardware and trauma in degeneration?
No.
No, yeah. No. That's where we're looking for the gel also for infection. It won't be a problem with the metals.
No metals.
And then from Bulgaria, are the chemoattractants proteins or cells?
The chemoattractants are proteins, are mainly proteins. But it could also be like some proteoglycans that have chemotactic activity, but not cells. And it can be factors released by dying cells. Also, nuclear factors have been shown to be chemoattractant.
Thanks, Sybil.
Thanks, Sybille. So next is Martin Stoder, who will describe the stem cell and mechanics.
So thank you, Mauro.
Interaction.
And what I want to try and get across over the next few slides is some indication of what are the factors which affect stem cell fate and how do mechanics regulate this. So a lot of this you'll be familiar with some of your fracture fixation and your fracture models. And then to give you an idea of what are the role of biomechanics and maybe try to emphasize a bit more how can this be implemented within a clinical setting. So when you look at how does a stem cell fate be decided? Well, we've already heard that there's the effect of homing into the injury site. And what tends to happen on a time of injury, there's a stimulus which then activates the cells. These cells then migrate towards the site of the injury, whether it be articular cartilage or whether it be bone, and they proliferate and expand during that time point. And as that expansion occurs, they change their phenotype and they change their behavior depending on the signals they see. So they will interact with other cells, they will interact with other matrix molecules, soluble factors as discussed in the previous talk, and that will change their behavior. And one thing where this is quite relevant is if we're looking at tissue engineering approaches, this is actually the monolayer expansion step for tissue engineers. So one thing you have to be very careful with is you can actually change the phenotype and change the behavior of MSCs or stem cells as you're proliferating them to expand them. So you could ruin your protocol before you've even begun. And then we all know from the literature now that these cells then can become bone, they can become cartilage, and they can become fat. And due to the wide nature of the cells, we know that some potentially can become bone and cartilage, but then they can't become fat anymore, or vice versa. And a very critical step for bone healing and for resting articular cartilage is the fact that we know that a lot of fractures heal by making a cartilaginous template, which then goes through to a bony structure, this endochondral ossification or hypertrophy. And so if you want bone, you want to manipulate that pathway to use that cartilaginous template. If you want resting cartilage in an intra-articular fracture, you want to inhibit that step. And we're very interested in that step within the ARI. We know now there are more of these paracrine effects, like discussed before, the immunomodulation effects. But actually, there's not a great deal known on the cellular level what exactly do mechanics do. And a number of cell culture studies, whether you're doing bone or cartilage, are done in static tissue culture conditions, whereas in a patient or an in vivo model, they would be mechanically loaded. And so we know from fracture models or computational models that when you have a fracture, if you have too much motion or too much tissue shear strain and fluid flow, you end up over here where you have some fibrous tissue which will lead to a non-union. If you have a relative micromotion fixation, you then come to a cartilaginous template which you would get mainly in long bones, which then endochondral ossification occurs leading to a bony structure. And that's in part because the structure itself stiffens and the tissue shear strain decreases, so the cells then start to remodel towards bone. And so now when you consider, if you're looking, for example, in a cartilage environment, when we do it statically in culture, one problem is we know these stem cells go through hypertrophy and become bony-like, and that's because there's no motion. We're in this area of the graph where you lead to a bony formation. So maybe mechanics themselves play a role in the outcome of these fate decisions. So within the ARI, we have this bioreactor system, which is a circular ceramic hip ball. Then we can have a cartilaginous construct or an implant with cells. And what we can do with this hip ball is we can apply compression, so we can load the construct, we can rotate the ball so we can apply shear, and we can rotate the holder so we can mimic the kind of loads that would be experienced by cells within an articulating knee joint. And one big advantage of this system is that because now we can use human cells under defined mechanical conditions, we can do kind of studies you can't do in animals. So when you're looking at the kind of translational model you might want, we would use cells. These black dots within this matrix here are the cells. They're human non-induced stem cells.
we would seed them into a fibrin gel, not because we think it's a very good chondrogenic induction methodology, but because this is clinically available, you could buy it tomorrow. And so you have human cells in a polyurethane with a scaffold, which is a sponge-like material, is to resist the load that you'd apply during the experimental conditions. And then we'll apply either with or without exogenous growth factors. For these kind of studies, which I'm going to discuss now, it's going to be mainly cartilage. And the reason these exogenous growth factors then would normally be TGF-beta, which would be the kind of growth factor you'd use to induce cartilaginous differentiation of human stem cells. And when you look at the chondrogenic response under load to these cells, what you find is if you add this 10 nanogram TGF-beta, the standard classical chondrogenic medium, the effect of load, which are the darker bars, is very limited. And so then it questions within a repair environment, where does the growth factor come from? And when you then take the growth factor out of the system completely, you then start to see these classical chondrogenic markers, such as aggrecan and collagen 2, are highly upregulated by mechanics alone with no growth factors in the system. Sometimes this is quite dependent on the concentration of TGF-beta, which I'll come back to. In other cases, like this superficial zone protein in the bottom corner, what you can see is that the highest expression of this lubricant protein, which would be very good for protecting an implant, is greatest when you do not give the chondrogenic stimulus, but you give mechanics purely alone. And so how does this work? And what we've found out using this system is that generally what happens is if you do not apply growth factors, but you apply the correct mechanical stimulus, it makes sense then that the cells themselves produce their own growth factors. And the type of mechanics you apply depends on which growth factors they make. And so what we found is we're using a proper loading regime with shear and compression, we can induce the cells to produce around 1 nanogram of TGF-beta per milliliter by themselves. When you then look at the gene expression profiles, you see some genes match this very well. So this collagen 10, for example, these two here have approximately the same amount of TGF-beta. One is exogenous applied, one is endogenous produced by the cells. The collagen 10 expression is very, very similar. It's very dose dependent. But again, when we come back to this superficial zone protein, this PRG4 lubricant, there is very great differences between the exogenous and endogenous. And the take-home message from that would be that when you're given single growth factors, you apply single pathways. Whereas if you give mechanics, you can induce multiple pathways in more coordinated chondrogenic differentiation. And so what is the particular mechanical force which the cells sense to behave like this? And what we found in this system is, if you look at these classical chondrogenic markers, compression alone does absolutely nothing at all in these cells. Shear has a tendency towards a chondrogenic differentiation, whereas it's the compression and shear group only which actually leads to chondrogenic differentiation, again due to this TGF-beta production. And then when you start to look at the glycosaminoglycan production, as you'd expect from the data you've seen already, that when you have compression alone, you just have a bit of fibrous tissue around the edge. Shear just gives you a smoother surface. But this purple metachromatic staining of glycosaminoglycan matrix proteins from the cells shows that they're going down a cartilaginous differentiation pathway. And the control just gives you the fibrous tissue you'd expect. So hopefully after this, I've managed to convince you that the biomechanics themselves affect stem cell behavior. And these are the reasons why you get indirect or direct bone healing, in part because of the source of the cells and the mechanics applied. And by doing this, you can use, for example, intra-articular repair rehabilitation protocols. So early and applied shear would be beneficial potentially for these kind of patients. And thank you for your attention, and I'll be more than willing to take questions.
Thanks, Martin. Question from the audience? Question from the web?
There was a question, but it just disappeared. About neoplastic and metaplastic effects.
Of stem cells, if they could create some or induce some neoplasma tumor.
These particular type of cells would are actually adult bone marrow-derived stem cells. So in all studies I've seen so far, there's been no sign of any risk of tumorigenic differentiation. Normally, actually, the problem is limited capacity rather than overcapacity.
Later on. Is it the general question about your opinion on platelet-rich plasma, which isn't really relevant to this talk, but the opinion's important?
But we actually, fortunately, we work with platelet-rich plasma a lot within the ARI as well. I think platelet-rich plasma is one of these where it's got potential, and I think one particular problem which is currently with platelet-rich plasma is the fact that there is such a broad range of mechanisms by which it can be produced, and there's very little control about what people are using in studies. And so what's been discovered in certain publications has been there's an actual sweet spot whereby if you concentrate it to a point, it works quite well, and if you over-concentrate it, more is not better and can actually make things worse and inhibit healing. So basically what needs better standardization is the actual controls of what you're actually producing and how you use it later.
So another question, another question that just disappeared was, so loading will create a compression shear gradually?
The loading regime, you can decide what you want to apply. So for example, if you were to use an articular fracture, you could think of a loading protocol where you apply constant passive motion with just shear first before you start then partial weight bearing, where you'd have compression and shear. So it really, that's the take-home message of the whole talk. Basically, you decide what differentiation you want, and then you decide which mechanics will give you that kind of differentiation, and that we can control.
And a general question, what type of micro-movement will improve tissue healing? Well, I think what Martin's showing here is for the cartilage, this would not be the same for bone healing, though you do need some micro-movement, as we see more and more. If you have absolute stability, you don't get any callus, so you do need micro-movement, but we can't say which.
And okay. It also depends on how the motion's travelled, because if you have a very soft gel, if you compress it, the actual strain the cell sees will be less than if you have a stiff material. So it all comes down to the exact cellular mechanics, not just the micro-motion.
And the final question, again from India, is which would be the best source for stem cells in clinical practice? That's a good question.
That's a really good question, because up until now, everyone's considered that a stem cell is a stem cell and it doesn't really matter where you get it from. It's becoming much more apparent now that depending on where you take your cells from depends on which potential they have and what potential they have for a certain lineage. So there are a number of questions now about whether adipose-derived stem cells will actually be clinically useful from the point of view of how well will they produce bone, because that's not what they're programmed to do. And there's also a lot of work going on in CMF applications, for example, to say as bone marrow-derived stem cells from a flat bone more suitable for CMF intramembranous repair than, for example, iliac crest-derived bone. So you really need to think about what tissue you're trying to repair and then decide where to take the cells from. And I think over the next few years, that will become a lot clearer.
Okay. Thanks, Martin. So more we know, less we know. Now, with Sophie Verrier, we will introduce the PRP.
The PRP and the stem cells and the critical size bone defect. So good afternoon, everybody, and I'm very happy to be able to present you my work today, or part of it. And I'm going to talk about the prevascularization of three-dimensional construct for the bone critical size defect application. So the question would be like, why that? I mean, like, the critical size bone defect are like not like other bone defect or bone healing. There are some very challenging situation in which the natural bone healing is not enough anymore. And the different systems that are currently used, the best system would be like the autologous bone graft. But in terms of the quantity that you would need to solve a large bone defect, it will be a very important limitation to use an autologous bone graft. Because, well, to talk about like the critical size bone defect that can occur for different reasons, there are different problems that the surgeon have to face. The most obvious problem is like the amount of the bone which has been lost. But again, in such cases, for example, like in high impact fractures or traumatology defect surgery, cases, you have a lot of soft tissues damages surrounding the bone defect, but also you have like a very highly blood supply damage. So what we try to do in this to solve this problem is to, well, in parallel, to solve the vascularity problem inside a three-dimensional scaffold that, in fine, will help the bone healing and then the functional recovery of the patient in limited time without limited side effect of autologous bone graft, for example. So the approach that we are following in the main case, or well, in our case, is to try to produce like an autologous artificial bone graft, meaning in this case, all the biological components that we want to use in our system are of an autologous origin. So those autologous origin components, we were talking just before about platelet-rich plasma. In our case, we are using like the platelet release growth factor, which is like a soluble form of the platelet growth factors that you can get. From the blood of a patient, you can isolate all those growth factors. And, well, according to some different studies that we were doing before, we could see that those platelet release growth factors have a positive influence on the growth and the future differentiation of different cell types. From the patient bone marrow, then we can isolate some endothelial progenitor cells. And those cells are known to be at the origin of the angiogenesis and well, be part of the neovascularization process and the formation of capillaries in the area where it's needed. From the bone marrow, we can also isolate mesenchymal stem cells. We were hearing about them just in the talk before. And now we know that when they are given the appropriate differentiation factor, they can differentiate in bone-forming cells, namely osteoblastic cells. So having all those three different, really strictly autologous biological components, our plan is to mix them in an artificial scaffold, which is chosen to be osteoconductive. And then having all those systems in the osteoconductive scaffold, we would be able to develop this scaffold in an osteoinductive and eventually osteogenic way. So when we put those cells in this scaffold, we aim to produce a prevascularization of this scaffold. But as I said, we are using two different cell types that are not necessarily happy to work together when they are putting in culture together. So in this case, we were taking those endothelial progenitor cells, we stained in green, and we mixed them together with mesenchymal stem cells stained in red. And we could see after 1 hour, you can distinguish the two different populations. But after 5 hours, you could see like the reorganization of those cells in a cellular network, which is usually typical for endothelial cells. But you can interestingly see the participation of the MSC population in this reorganization in a cellular network. After 24 hours, you can see like these structures are getting more complex and more organized. And again, you can see the presence of the two cell types within the construct. But that was in two-dimensional. What we want at the end is to reach this type of results in a three-dimensional system. In this case, the MSCs and the EPCs were seeded together with the platelet release growth factors in a three-dimensional scaffold, and they were cultured in vitro for 7 days. And that our aim is to, increase the osteogenesis fate of this construct, but also the vascular genesis. So after 7 days in culture, we were taking those materials and we were freezing down them, and we did make some cryosections of this material. Those sections were about 10 micrometers thickness. So these sections were stained with markers specific for endothelial cells in this case. What you can see here, this is the scaffold. Then what you can see here is like very organized structures which were like positive for endothelial cell markers. And when I look at those structures, I was thinking maybe we could look at the consecutive section. So we did that. We took another section about, in this case, 80 micrometers away, further down in the scaffold, and we could really see, like if you can recognize the structure of the scaffold, you can really imagine this is like the really further down a section. And we could see the following of these structures down there here. So which shows us that those structures are not only like circular and two-plane structures, but really are tubular structures. So vascular or capillary-like structures. But if you remember what I was showing before of those different cell types combining to each other to make some reorganization capillary-like structures in two-dimensional, we were asking ourselves, would that be the same in the three-dimensional application? And what would be those cells from the MSC that are participating in the cell reorganization? So we were doing some immunostaining as well for other cell markers. In this case, we were looking at pericytes, because pericytes are known to be involved in the stabilization of new form capillaries. So we were looking at the markers for those pericytes, and here, as you can see in the white circle areas, we could see and follow cross down the section, so they are the same material taken at different levels, that those areas were positive for all the different markers for the pericytes. So saying that, I mean, those tubular-like structures were positive for endothelial marker cells, but also showed positive response for pericyte cells, and pericyte cells are part of the mural cells from blood vessels. But our final aim would be not only to promote the neovascularization, but also to promote the bone neoformation. So that's reason why in another setup or in the parallel, we were analyzing what is the devenir or the what is happening to the MSCs toward the osteoblastic phenotype. And in this case, we perform some immunostaining to using osteoblastic differentiation marker. In this case, we use alkaline phosphatase. And when the MSCs were cultured on their own, you can see all the cells are present. You can distinguish them because of the nuclei everywhere, but nothing is much happening. But when the EPCs, the MSCs were co-cultured with the endothelial progenitor cells, we could distinguish at certain area of the scaffold a positive response for the alkanes phosphatase expression, showing that the MSCs were able to differentiate toward an osteoblastic phenotype, but that was occurring only in co-culture system. So to sum up, like all those observations that we did in this three-dimensional analysis of the scaffold, that there is a very important beneficial effect of MSCs and endothelial progenitor cells co-cultured in a three-dimensional scaffold. There is like a real important cell-cell communication, because all those fates were not able, or we were not able to observe like all those fates when one of the population was cultured on its own or the other one. So in the co-culture system, we could like enhance like a cell-cell communication and a synergy of differentiation of those two cell types. And what we wanted to look at in this particular talk I present here is like the formation of luminal tubular structure network, which were positive for endothelial cells, but also pericyte cells markers. So now this was in vitro. Now we want to assess the functionality of those nice structures in vivo, and those scaffolds have been like implanted in the mouse like 2 weeks ago, so it's a little bit too early to see if those scaffolds are really integrating to the surrounding microvascularization of a living host. And well, I hope that I will be able to give an answer soon. And I would say that what is important out of all this story is like it will be really possible in the future to use like, 100% autologous origin biological component to associate them in a three-dimensional scaffold to promote the prevascularization of the scaffold prior to implantation. So what my fate or my important point here is like really autologous origin. So if you can take everything autologous, put it in a synthetic scaffold, you are as close as possible as the autologous bone graft. So if you have any question, I would be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Sophie. So we have two questions from the web while waiting for the audience here. Jeff?
Question from Ecuador. What about nerve damage?
Well, nerve damage are also an important factor there, and there are some different cells implying in there, but this is like, I would say, this is something that we have to take in consideration, but our approach at the moment is like, we want to, well, step by step to find out, can we produce this prevascularization? But then we will be using, in a future project, probably some factor that are also able to stimulate the nerval.
Look at the TV.
Where is it? Ah, here. Okay.
Okay. And the other question is, what are the chances it will be used clinically in the future? But I think that's the same question as all these biological answers. It depends on how easy it is to get through approval, because you've answered the rest in your talk.
Well, the thing is, like, using autologous cells just limit, like, all the administration work to get approvals, etc., because those cells would be autologous. So the only concern about getting approval or not would be the choice of the biomaterial that you will be doing. So, and, yeah, so.
Okay. Thanks.
Nope. Thank you, Sophie. Yep. So next is Vincent Staderman, who will present us some work on diagnostic-friendly implants.
Thank you. So I will talk about research that we do at the AO Research Institute about imaging, and we mainly work with computed tomography and sometimes with implants. Computed tomography, CT, and micro-CT are routine procedures in hospitals and routine procedures in research laboratories. They are very well suited to produce images of bone structures. They provide a very good contrast and generally a good resolution for the subject. However, computed tomography and implant is much more problematic. Around implant, one can see artifacts, and these artifacts are of two kinds: streaks that are generated from the image that will change the values of your contrast everywhere in the image, making it not usable for quantitative analysis. And also around the implant, one will not be able to analyze any structures, as you can see, because they are shadowed by glow of the implant. To understand why this is happening, one has to open the box, and inside the CT, what you will find is a tube, an X-ray that produces X-ray, and a detector. Tube, detector. The tube and the detector rotate around your object, and at every step of rotation, an X-ray projection is shot and is recorded. The sum of all these projections will make a sinogram, and the sinogram will then be used and transformed to make a reconstruction image. The first part here is the physics that happen inside the CT. It's a projection, and we assume that the projection can be reconstructed if the average projection is measured here. But the problem is that if you have an implant, this assumption is broken. Whatever you have on your root of X-ray before an implant will make no difference on the contrast that is recorded on the detector. Even worse, sometimes the detector can record X-rays that were not even on the path of the normal X-rays but are scattered. So the first strategy to overcome the problem was to apply filters to the reconstructed images. And this filter, as you can see, they can reduce the noise quite a lot. You have a whole range of filters that are from the most simple to the most sophisticated one. And even the sophisticated ones like this one will not really make the image usable if you're interested about things that happen around the implant. Further away, they may be a bit better. So the next strategy is to think about the physics that is happening inside a computed tomograph. And the physics, there are three parameters that one can take into account. The energy of the incoming X-rays can be changed. The material of the object maybe has an influence on the attenuation, and the size of the object. So the X-ray, you cannot really change it in a CT, because if you increase your X-ray energy in general, the dose to the patient will be too high. So this is limited by biology of radiology. The size, if we talk about an implant, in general the implant is defined by function, or is designed by function. It has to be able to support the weight of the patient, and you cannot really make it smaller, otherwise it will probably break. So finally, the only thing that you can change in your problem is the material that you use in an implant. And if you use a material that has a lower attenuation coefficient, you can let some X-rays go through it, and so you will record some X-rays in your in each projection, instead of having the data completely lost. So an example of what we can do with such implants is, for example, infections around implant. So here I will present shortly an animal model of a screw that was infected before it was implanted in a rat. First, if we choose a screw made of titanium, what happens is these artifacts and streaks and glow, and of course one cannot see any change in the bone around the implant. In contrary, if one uses PEEK screws, the structure of the bone around the screw is perfectly preserved in the image, and this becomes usable. So what we did here, we repeated the scans every second day after these screws were implanted in the rats, and we waited until there was no more bone around the screw. The quality of the image is enough so that you can then overlap them in the space, register them as you wish, and you can look at every single detail of the bone changes at every time point. For example, you can identify bone that has not changed from the last time, bone in orange here, bone that has disappeared from the last time in brownish, and new bone in yellow around the screw. Then you can start to quantify how much new bone and how much resorbed bone has been there, and you can at each time point of the experiment calculate how much resorption and formation has happened. This is called dynamic histomorphometry, and you can compare the control animals in plain here lines, new bone in red, resorbed bone in green, compare the infected animals in dashed, and probably this approach could lead on the long term to a diagnostic tool where patterns of bone formation and resorption can be recognized around an implant. But the take-home message is, with current implant, it's not possible. One has to use implants that will let some X-rays go through. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you, Vincent. So what would be the advantage of this application? You know, you could use different time point with animals, or
So there are two things. Of course, for research with lab animals, the loads are much smaller than in humans, so you can really think about any implant made of PEEK, and you can have images that will reveal the integration of these implants. If you look at integration, reveal infections like in this study at every time point. Or if you look at drug delivery from the implant, you can also start maybe coloring or labeling these drugs and follow them in space. In clinics, it's maybe on the long term, but also we can think about diagnostics, new diagnostics, if the implants don't make artifacts.
So there's one question from the web. What is PEEK? Well, PEEK is polyether ether ketone. It's translucent to X-rays. You use it in patient-specific implants, such as cranial defects, and it's used also in areas sometimes as screws and so on, where you are concerned, as Vincent has shown, for imaging problems. Are there any other questions from the audience to Vincent? Okay, well, I'm glad he's opened up how a CT can be used to you a little bit, and thanks, Vincent. And now we move on to our fellow. This is the first fellow who's speaking. That's Daniel Wagner, and he's over from Mainz in Germany, though he's actually Swiss, working together with us.
Thank you. So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I will present you preliminary results of a study about the 3D morphology of the sacrum and its impact on treating sacral insufficiency fractures. This study is a collaboration of AO Research Institute researchers and trauma surgeons from Germany and Japan, and I myself am, as said, a medical research fellow. The clinical background of this study is the increasing number of sacral insufficiency fractures as more and more patients are affected by osteoporosis. These fractures can occur unilateral, bilateral, or form even a H pattern, as we see on the upper right. Sometimes there is even a spinopelvic dissociation present. The golden standard in the treatment of these fractures is conservative treatment, but there is a considerable rate of complications as urinary tract or pulmonary infections, skin breakdown, deep venous thrombosis, or what concerns the fracture healing, prolonged fracture healing with pain or even malunion. Interventional possibilities to treat this fractures is sacroplasty, and for surgery there are different modalities as normal SI screw, augmented SI screw, transsacral screw, or even transsacral position bars. The sacral anatomy itself is highly variable, and in the literature up to 35% are called dysmorphic. What is interesting for sacral insufficiency fractures is that the bone stock distribution within the sacrum in the elderly is not very well known. So our goal is to establish a scientific anatomical basis for the development of new fracture fixation concepts for these fractures. What we use is routine clinical CTs from intact pelvis, and we do 3D statistical modeling with them, and can compare now elderly and younger and Asians to Europeans. Now what you see here is a 3D statistical model of the sacral surface. What you see in the middle is the mean shape in gray of 20 individual sacra. So you don't see an individual sacrum, you see the mean shape of 20 different ones. On the left and on the right in yellow, you see the statistical extreme deviations done with principal component analysis. What you see is that the form and the form is very variable. Now we have the same model and we look from lateral in a semi-transparent view. What we see nicely is here on S1 level, the transsacral corridor, and also on S2 and S3 level. We have again on left and right the statistical extreme shapes, and we see that the transsacral corridors are changing a lot with the whole anatomy of the sacrum. When we do now virtual implant positioning of a transsacral implant, as you see on the left, we have here two individual sacra, and we see how this anatomy is influencing the place for transsacral screw positioning, as in the middle one we can place three different screws, and on the right one it's just possible to place one transsacral implant. Another model we did is the average bone density derived from CT Hounsfield units. Again, we see a mean shape, so it's not an individual sacrum, it's the mean of 20 different sacra. And we see sections on S1 level on the left and on S2 level on the right. And we see already a distinct pattern of bone stock distribution, as in the ARI region, where normally sacral insufficiency fractures occur, there is less bone stock, as in the vertebral body region here in the middle. So what have we seen in this preliminary results is that the sacral anatomy is highly variable, that this does influence the transsacral corridors, which has itself an impact on surgical decision making regarding the site of implant positioning or the sacral level, and the number and type of transsacral implants which can be used. We have seen a distinct pattern of bone stock distribution, which may explain the fracture patterns we see in sacral insufficiency fractures, typically occurring in the paraforaminal lateral zone. So these anatomical data I presented you may improve the nowadays challenging surgical fixation strategies of these fractures. Thank you very much for your attention. Are there any questions?
Any questions from the audience? The only one on the web is actually to the last talk, which is asking about, is there any harm to the patient with steel hardware exposed to MRI? Actually, Daniel, you should be able to answer that one. I'll answer it then. The answer is no. There is no harm to a patient with metal implants in when you have an MRI. It just makes a problem for the imaging. There's no harm for the patient at all if you have metal inside you. So it's not a question for you, but that was a test, as he's a fellow. Right, the first question for you. Do you recommend routine CT scanning before sacral fracture fixation?
Yes. We have seen there are criteria defined on plain X-ray by route. They are quite good, but in the CT you get a better view of how the corridor is for implant positioning, and especially in sacra where you don't have a lot of corridor, you have to change the implant or the direction which your implant is taking. Or you even have to change the implant from transsacral to normal SI screw.
And I'd like to thank you for that question. Samit, you've been bringing in quite a lot of questions to us, and they're all good questions. Keep them coming, please. Any more questions from the audience before we move on to the next talk? Sometimes the problem is with the internet, it's a little bit slow from if it's coming in from Latin America or Asia to get the questions in. But any late questions that come in, if you go on our website, send them to the Research Institute, we will pass them to the appropriate people and answer them for you for sure. Okay, so no more from audience. Thank you, Daniel.
Thanks.
And we move on to the next one. And that is from Christoph Sprecher, and he will be talking on the distal radius fracture resorption. There you go, Christoph. Thank Kronos.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure for me to show you the the project about the resorption characteristic of Kronos Inject in the distal radius fracture. These fractures are really common in elderly patients. It's a typical female fracture, as you all know, and it's related to age and osteoporosis. We have plenty of biodegradable cements available, and they are often in use in clinics, but they are not really in detail described. We have a sheep study, which shows us a resorption rate of 90% after 6 months, and we have a CT study after based on X-rays after 6 and 12 months. But nothing more is clearly. Therefore, we propose this study to investigate the resorption characteristics of Kronos Inject in human patients. Here the cement was applied to metaphyseal bone void in dorsally displaced distal radius fractures. The patient collective was enrolled by the University of Innsbruck. You see, I think it's quite typical for these patients with age and the fracture classification. If you look on some clinical images, we see here a CT section of a preoperative distal radius fracture, and we can see here the postoperative X-ray, blue marked is the injected Kronos cement. On the plate removal, we have here the image before the plate removal and here after one, and with the arrow is pointed to the rest of the Kronos Inject. Before the plate removal, there was taken a biopsy out of the fracture zone through the second hole, and then this biopsy was put into the micro CT with resolution of 15 microns. But you can see here, dark green is the bone and light green are the particles from the Kronos Inject. If we look now on the histological section of that sample of that biopsy, then we see it is more or less corresponding, but it is a bit astonishing that we see this inhomogeneous distribution of the chronos inject. The goal was to analyze that a bit more in detail. We did histomorphology on it, and we see here on the higher magnified image that we have red the osteoid and green the bone. If we do that calculation on all six patients and we build a bone osteoid ratio, then we see that the first three have a completely other, a much higher ratio than the second three. That is relating to the osteoporosis medication. So we see that this medication clearly influence also the bone healing in these six patients. If we go a bit more detailed to the to the Masson Goldner trichrome stain, then we see we have these holes in which surrounded by a thin layer of bone or osteoid. Here you can see it shown, here can you see it with the arrows. If you go and look on the same or on the next section with methylene blue, so we see marked with an asterisk, we see some chronos inject parts which are still there. So that means these parts are lost in the Masson Goldner trichrome stain. That is a processing artifact. So what is the conclusion? Chronos inject is still present in elderly patients after 15 months. It is well integrated in the newly formed trabecular bone. It is resorbed to a really high percentage. Histologically, there are no alarming adverse signs of tissue reaction. That result indicates for us that chronos inject is a possibility in metaphyseal bone weights of distal radius fracture instead of autologous bone graft in osteoporotic patients. Oops. Thank you from my side.
Thank you, Christoph. What that also shows is be careful what you believe when you read a paper. Papers may say that cements or polymers dissolve very quickly, and then you actually find this is wrong. This is just an artifact of the technique they've used. And this clearly showed that between the Masson Goldner trichrome staining and the normal methylene blue staining. One of them said that it dissolved, one hadn't. So you've really got to have at least one or two methods to actually check that the cement is still there. So that's an important point. So we have a question from the audience, Dirk.
Yeah, one question. These have been all intra-articular fractures. Have you seen any leakage of cement into the joint?
No.
Microphone.
Sorry. Weapon. No, not up to now. I mean, that is an obvious problem, but we haven't seen something like that as a clinical problem.
So we had a web question. It just disappeared, but it asked if this cement can be used in trochanteric fractures, Christoph.
I think this cement is from Synthes side and from FDA side accepted for all fractures, but with the limitation that the fixation has to be stable. That is the main issue. There shouldn't be not a really high load on it.
One from the audience.
When you mentioned that there is an effect for osteoporotic treatment, what type of treatment were the patients on? And what actually did that affect the chronic os absorption?
It's a good question. We just recorded if this patient get bisphosphonate or not. And I mean, we have seen that on six patients. That means one group is three patients. I mean, that is, in general, I would say a weak statement, but it's from the number side quite impressive that it is such a large difference. And the bisphosphonate reduce the resorption. So we assume it's also influenced here with the resorption of the chronos inject, which is, let's say, calcium phosphor combination.
There was one question from the web, is if you could add BMP2 with the Kronos, and I don't think it's approved for that, is it?
Yeah, I think it's not approved. There are some studies around of combination of calcium phosphor cements and BMPs and similar materials.
And I'd advise be careful with BMPs. There are more and more papers coming out with problems with BMPs, so just keep an eye on the papers. A final question from the web, again from Samit in India. Do you recommend mixing Kronos with autogenous bone graft?
From my side, I cannot give a recommendation. I'm not a clinician.
And I don't think it's actually done at the moment, so
there is no study around.
Yeah, there's no study on that. Sorry. Okay. Thanks, Christoph.
Thank you. Oh. Thank you. Nadine Hoffman-Fleury will discuss about latest research in osteoporosis.
Good afternoon, everybody. Osteoporosis was defined by AOTrauma as one of the research focuses, and one of the hot topics in osteoporosis research is implant augmentation. I will present or give a short overview of five small projects that run the past year, augmentation projects, and these were actually all run by one of our research fellows we had there. You can see here also they're very internationally represented here. 2 years ago, we showed in a biomechanical study when augmenting the proximal femoral nail that that it improved the biomechanics considerably and significantly. We had a 51% increase in sustaining in accepting cycles until it failed compared to non-augmented samples. This technique has found its way into clinics. And also there, it shows very promising results with, up to now, no complications. Based on this promising results, we wanted to look at other body regions which might profit from an augmentation. And we looked at, for example, at the distal femur or at the proximal tibia. We investigated if an augmentation of the distal, respectively the proximal screws of the corresponding list plate, would lead to an advantage. We did a paired test in cadaveric samples. We placed the samples on a materials testing machine in a physiological orientation, and we tested the cycles until failure. And we could show for both projects a similar significant increase in the sustaining cycles until failure as we could show for the PFNA. Next to biomechanics, we also looked at safety issues. In one of the studies, we looked at the temperature. Last year, it was shown that augmenting the proximal femoral nail with up to 6 milliliter did not reach any critical temperatures, and we wanted to repeat this study for the proximal humerus because we go very near to the cartilage there, and we looked particularly on temperatures which arise on the cartilage surface and in the subchondral bone. We measured the temperatures in the subchondral bone and on the cartilage while or during augmentation of four proximal screws of the phyllos plates, and also there we did not reach any critical threshold values reported in the literature. Another study focusing on the safety of the technique looked at intraosseous pressures. It is one theory that too high pressures in the femoral head could lead to avascular necrosis, and we wanted to see if by injecting high amounts or up to 6 milliliter of cement somewhere where nothing is removed beforehand, if we might maybe produce some critical pressures. So we placed pressure transmitters in femoral heads, and we measured the pressures while injecting up to 6 milliliter of cement, and we did not reach any critical pressure values reported in the literature. For the last study, I'll go back again to a biomechanical study where we wanted to investigate the effect of augmentation of three cannulated hip screws for femoral neck fractures. It's three hip screws, cannulated hip screws in a triangular configuration. And now a question for you. For once, if you look at these two constructs, again, we place them on a material testing machine in a physiological orientation, and we tested until failure. One group got conventional instrumentation with three cannulated screws. The other one had an additional augmentation of 5 to 6 milliliter of PMMA. So what do you think, which of these two groups fails earlier, the augmented one or the non-augmented one, or is there maybe no difference? What do you think?
The non-augmented one.
The non-augmented fail earlier, okay. That's what many people would say, I guess. That was also what we were expecting in the beginning, but surprisingly, if we look at the results in this case, the augmented ones fail significantly earlier compared to the non-augmented ones. So in this case, the augmentation had a negative effect, or if you look at the 3 millimeter actual displacement of the head, no difference in the cumulative survival. So the take-home message for you: augmentation is safe in terms of temperatures and pressures. It shows very high biomechanical advantages for certain specific implants, like the proximal femoral nail, the phyllos plate, the LCP for the distal femur, or the proximal lateral tibia, but it cannot be applied as a routine concept in every implant. It is the indication for augmentation is needs to be considered carefully and evaluated beforehand. It is highly dependent on the implant, on the fracture, and also on the failure mode you see in clinics. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ladina. So what is obvious, sometimes it's not. Question? So why, okay.
Can you use something like the absorbable cement, the Kronos, for this augmentation?
In this case, we talk about implant augmentation in very old patients, so in osteoporotic patients. And the most important thing there is that it's completely stable fixation. And Kronos is just not strong enough. It's not weight-bearing. So you need, in this case, it's the cement which takes the load. So and Kronos is not able to do that.
Yes. Thank you.
Ladina. Why you think that this implant fail in the femoral head compared to the other?
In this case, we have the difference that the screws, they are in the back, they are not angular stable, so they are free to move. And the failure happens rather in the back, not at the tip at the screws. So the cement makes it even more stiff and maybe even promotes the samples or the screws to bend down. The screws change their angle and it breaks down at the distal part of the screws. The failure happens then. So in this case, maybe if we would augment farther back, it would have an advantage. But augmenting the tips doesn't help, makes it even more stiff and even makes that the screw travels through the bone easier in the backside. So nothing, we could see that nothing happens. Actually, there's no cut through or something in the head. Between cement and bone, nothing happens at all. It's in the failed mode, it's still at the same place. It's not that the cement breaks away or something. It's just that the screws at the distal part, they move through the bone where it's not augmented in the back.
Okay, Ladina, so you've shown quite well that the heat doesn't seem to cause a problem from the polymerization, but PMMA is fairly cytotoxic. Are there any other materials that you will be looking at to replace PMMA for long-term future?
There are upcoming biodegradable materials which are not toxic. The problem is with biodegradable materials, I don't know if in very old patients really want the material to disappear again, because they cannot really reform bone so fast or so easy as younger patients. But for a little bit younger patients where augmentation might be of interest, this is for sure something we are looking into. Yeah.
Good.
Okay, thanks, Ladina. There are no more questions. And now it's Markus Windel with his new concept. We keep him last the cherry.
Yeah, keep the cherry at the cake till the end. Yeah.
Cherry of the cake. I hope that is the case.
No pressure.
Thanks, no pressure at all. This is the last talk, I think, or I hope that you have some attention left for me this afternoon. I would like to show you what we are doing in the field of concept development in the AO Research Institute. There we are trying to develop new technological solutions in order to make the life of the surgeon, the daily life in the operation theater, a little bit more easy and simple. And oh, there's a slide missing, doesn't matter. So then we go directly to the first of these concepts, because I would like to show you two of these. And one deals with positioning implants in a simple and effective way. And therefore, we developed a new kind of a navigation system, but which does not require cost-intensive, complicated standard navigation solutions. So we believe that the X-ray, the plain X-ray, as provided by a simple C-arm, which is available in all of the clinics, or in most of the clinics, provides much more information than we use at the moment. Therefore, we developed that system, which uses the X-rays, which are transferred to an external computer. There's image processing going on, and together with a slight modification of current instruments and implants, what you can see over here, we are able to provide a navigation solution for that. So the first application which we developed, I would like to show you, is the distal interlocking. This is, for all the surgeons here, still a problem which is unsolved, and to show you how it works, I would like to show you a video. This is our, we call it universal aiming arm. Before we implant the nail, it is pre-calibrated to a specific nail, so like this. And we call it universal because you can use it for all types of nails. You can use it for femoral nails, you can use it for tibia nails. You can see it here for the medial lateral direction or for the AP direction. Position these calibration balls into the locking holes. You take the balls out. You remove the arm and put it to the side. And then, when you inserted the nail, you put it back. You take one single image of the situation. This image is then transferred to the external computer, and the system directly gives you a correction value to compensate for the nail bending. So you set that correction value at the arm. Take a control image in order to control your position. The system then confirms your correct alignment with the green light here, and the rest is then standard drilling and inserting the bolt. That means for inserting two locking screws, you need only one X-ray image. So this reduces time, effort, and X-ray exposure to the minimum. We could use this principle for many other applications, and this is the advantage of that solution. We could, for example, use it to position a leg screw in the center of the femoral head from two images, which have not to be perpendicular. The system then suggests you the depth of the nail, the required rotation of the nail in order to hit the center of the head, and also the suggested length of the implant. Another application is the femoral antiversion, which is often a problem when the patient comes out of the operation theater with a mal rotated legs. We would like to avoid that, and therefore the system is able to calculate the current antiversion of the femur before you insert the locking bolts in order to avoid mal rotation. Module that we developed is a general module for plating. So by just adding this little add-on device to a standard drill sleeve, here case of a phyllos plate for the proximal humerus, you have a complete navigation solution. So the system tells you all the screw paths from two images and also the screw lengths for each of these screws in order to get as close as possible to the subchondral bone, but not to penetrate into the joint. So this is crucial, as the surgeons here know, for especially the old unstable patients with osteoporosis. This image shows you the accuracy of the system. Here, experimentally, we set the tip apex distance, that means the distance between the tip of the screw and the cartilage, to zero, so that all the screws should just penetrate into the joint, which you, of course, should not do in clinics. But for us, it's interesting to see here and to have an idea how accurate that system works. So what's the principle behind all these applications? It's all about holes. So we do image processing based on simple holes. We detect in an image these explicit characteristic shape of an oblique through hole, and from there we can calculate back to the spatial orientation of the hole. And this is the idea behind. We use holes for tracking. The second concept I would like to show you is on bone healing. We developed a system which is meant to monitor the healing progression of patients. So for that, the idea, which is not really a novelty, but what we are also following, is that we believe that we can monitor the progression of the healing indirectly by measuring the deformation of an implant. So because if the callus forms, the load transferred over the image is reduced, and then by reduced motion of the implant, the fracture will consolidate. That means this kind of approach can be used for monitoring of bone healing in clinics. It can help to detect early disturbances of the healing. It could give you information about the activity and the weight bearing of the patient. And more on a research side, it could help to understand the healing processes better as we know them at the moment. Therefore, our principle works in a way that we have a small implantable computer which does data processing on the raw data. This is continuous recording of deformation under patient load bearing over time. And this system calculates and transfers important data directly to the outside. So that means, speaking in terms of images, we don't want to take all the grapes and transfer them to the outside. We just first do the grappa from the grapes and just transfer the grappa, because it's much, much easier. Because what you do at the end, everybody of us wants the grappa and not the grapes, that's clear. So that's what we are aiming here as well. Can show you two different streamlines, parallel work streams of that work. One is the preclinical research, where we are more doing testing in an animal model. This is a plate which is designed for the sheep tibia that can compress in a defined way, so it gives a dynamization to the fracture. The electronic is here inside that housing. It can be stored under the skin, and then the data is transferred without any wire to the outside. So one of the parameters that you can get from that is, for example, the amplitude. That means the motion, the displacement per stroke of the animal. And as you can see here, this curve is decreasing over time in consistence with the radiographs. On the other hand, we would like to gather some clinical data in that already quite early stage, and therefore we are aiming at clinical research, a small clinical trial. We developed a system based on the same principle, which can be attached to an external fixator sidebar and measures the deformation of the external fixator. We are going here for the external fixator because we can apply that easily to a patient by minimizing the patient risk, because it's applied outside, attached outside, there's no risk for the patient anymore. So you can see here the system. This is the RFID transponder, which delivers data to this this tablet computer where the data processing is going on. So the take-home message of that talk would be that the ARI develops in various aspects of today's fracture treatment, and we have the overall goal to ease and improve patient care worldwide. Thank you very much. Happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Marcus. Are there any questions from the audience? So we have one question over here. And maybe while you're bringing the microphone over, I'll answer the question that I've been waiting for all day for every talk. When will this solution be available? And that was our first question from the Netherlands. And Marcus, probably I should answer this rather than you, I'd think. This is a very important area for us. We've tested it out with our trustees. There was nearly 70 people who came to see this in June, trustees from all over the world from the AO. They loved it. They really wanted to have it. They asked the same question. And what we're trying to do at the moment is we're trying to set up a spin-off of how to do this, because this system will work with any C-arm anywhere, meaning you're unlikely to go with a partnership with an imaging company because they don't make the little extra parts that we'd need for, say, the drill sleeve. This cannot be made by an imaging company. And then when you go down the line of an implant trauma company, then you're limited to only having this technological use to their implants, whereas we believe this will be able to help everyone everywhere and with any C-arm. So we're looking at a small spin-off. It'll be our third spin-off from the foundation, the first being, well, fourth. The first was actually Synthes, which was quite a big spin-off. The second was Synbone. The third was ReSystem, which has just gone for the implants, and now this hopefully will be our fourth spin-off. So it'll take a little bit of time, but we will get it out there. And also the bit, not just for the aiming, also for the actual measurement of the bone healing. I think this has really got huge potential. And now we have a question for you from India. How soon can we expect the add-on softwares for a conventional C-arm to assist nailing and plating procedures?
This is a short, good question. It requires a long answer, which I cannot give you at that moment. It's simply, I don't know how long this will take. It will definitely not be available soon, but all the signs at the moment show that this will be an important future step. May it this system or be it a different one, it will be, that's my prediction, that in the future computer assistance in surgery will increase when we have simple systems and not these complicated ones.
Now we have a question from our audience.
I wanted to find out the device. Is it for a specific nail, or all types of nail can use the device for the targeting?
Which device? You mean the navigation or the
other? Yeah, the navigation system for the interlocking system for the nails.
I mean, we believe that the strength of this system is the generic use of it. So we don't want to provide only one solution for, let's say, the distal locking. Finally, the system should be able to assist you in many different ways. That means for plating, for nailing, for inserting the locking screws, and many other applications. Of course, we have to start small, so we cannot do everything at the same time from the beginning, but the overall aim is to make it very generic.
No, my question is, can you use this? Use the microphone, because we're on a webinar. Thanks.
The question is, can we use this device for, let's say, Synthes nail or Escular nail?
There's no restrictions. You can use that technology for any implant, but we would probably start with only a few, but that's not clear yet. Yeah.
So the idea, you could use it for any, but of course, if a company would like to buy our technology off us, then it's more likely to be to the one company. But if not, it'll be developed to be used for all. Any other questions? Okay then, so we have one there. Isabella, can you take the microphone over to the side under the bright lights?
I just wanted to bring your attention to the fact that Smith and Nephew has something like this on the market, which also aims to reduce radiation. Are they going to be similar or?
Yeah. Thank you for this question. We know that. We know that system. It definitely works. It's probably not a bad solution. The problem with it is you can only use it for one application, which is the distal interlocking, and then it's done. So you need that system. You need to buy everything of that, attach to your nails, and you have cables, and you have an external computer, everything. And the only thing you can do is distal locking. So we would like to avoid that, to have it only for one solution.
So you can't use it for the proximal. They put a magnetic cable down the nail. Once you take that out, you've done the distal locking, which isn't your clinical way. Normally you do the proximal, then you do the distal. So you take that out, and then you have to guess again with x-rays. Our system, you would do it more the clinical way, which would be proximal, rotation, and finally then distal. And you can use it for other areas, and there's no additional hardware. And of course, if your surgeon has some metal implants in their hand and so on while they're operating, this will also mess with the magnetism. So it's not using what you already have there within every operation room. And a C-arm, whether it's digital or analog, could be used with this system. So then, one second. We have an investigation. Okay, so I'd like to thank everyone for the time. This is my first time moderating a webinar, and also I guess Mauro's first time moderating a webinar. It's quite intense trying to keep up with the questions here while the talks are going on, but it was, for myself as a moderator, it was a good experience. I hope for yourselves as participants here and also throughout the world, this was great to see throughout the world. We have a multinational research team, and we see we have a multinational audience today, and this is great. So I've really enjoyed it, and I look forward to our next one. Thank you, everyone, for your time.